Hello and welcome. I am Bharat Swai and this is News Laundry's Facebook Live on early childhood in India. Why should we care? I'm sure you must be wondering why we're doing this topic today. Before you start wondering any further, there are three killer news that we came across in the last 3 weeks. India has a ranking of 100 in the Global Hunger Index. We are worse than Nepal and Bangladesh. Heck, we are even worse than North Korea. Only Afghanistan and Pakistan seem to be doing worse than us in Asia. India contributes 24% of the global neonatal deaths in the entire world. That is children who die within the first 28 days of their life. And Kerala and UP, we've seen the chief ministers of Kerala and Uttar Pradesh in at war of words about who has to learn what from each other about health. And equally important, a few months ago, we read in the Lancet study series that India has a global burden of 16% of the population, but 20% of global disease. Our health access index is getting better, but it's not where it should be. It should not be like this. It must not be like this. Still wondering why we're doing this topic? I think sahi question aapka ye hona chahiye. Why hasn't there been dedicated series on this? And why aren't we talking about it much more often? So we are very proud to announce that we are launching a series on early childhood under focus. As part of News Laundry, this is part of a global fellowship that we have won, that is your anchor, MOA, with the endorsement of News Laundry, and we'll be taking deep dive on everything around early childhood development, why it matters, why we should care, not just the maa-baap of the children, not just the line ministries like Women and Child Development or Health and Family Welfare, not just the researchers, not just the activists, but every single one of us, why should we care? And we'll be taking deep dive, especially with focus on nutrition and children of migrant workers. Today we have a kick-ass panel. I've heard a lot of people trolling about my use of word kick-ass, but wait, ek bar introduce karungi, then you'll know the only English word that qualifies for this panel is a kick-ass. We've got Dr. N.C. Saxena. Dr. Saxena, say hello.
Hello.
Say hello into the mic.
Hello.
He's a scholar, administrator, public intellectual, retired bureaucrat who is a leading light on development and social policy. Even the socio-economic caste census, yaad hai, 2 saal pehle Bihar election ke time mein socio-economic caste census was a massive mudda. He is the designer of the socio-economic caste census. Today he is with us in his avatar as the Supreme Court's Commissioner on Right to Food, Nutrition and Maternity Entitlements. What it essentially means is, wo Supreme Court ke aankh aur kaan hai on everything around food, nutrition and maternity entitlements. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Dr. Neelam Clare, she is Padma Bhushan, leading neonatologist of the world. She heads the Neonatology and Pediatrics Department of the Sir Gangaram Hospital. Welcome, Neelam. Say hello.
Thank you, Viraj. Hello, everybody.
Sumitra Mishra, she is the Executive Director of Mobile Crèches, a leading non-profit dedicated to early childhood care for the most marginalized children, especially children of migrant workers and construction workers. Welcome, Sumitra.
Thank you, Viraj, and glad to be a part of your kick-ass panel.
Thank you. Chidamanda Ngozi Adichie, one of the leading African authors and public intellectuals, says there is an importance of telling different stories, telling different narratives, not being captured by a single narrative, a single worldview, a single gaze. We've got a kick-ass panel also because we want to listen to truthful stories, but equally different stories. And all of them have different worldviews and different world of work. Full disclosure, we also tried to get 2 senior officials from the Women and Child Development Ministry. Unfortunately, because of the political sensitivities around and the recent spate of news, we have not got any of them. But we really hope, considering we are doing an engaging series of conversation and not adversarial shouting matches, we should be getting senior officials sooner than later. Let's begin. So what is early childhood development? Give us a working definition from your world of work and tell us, is it just limited to the woman, their house, home, hearth and home economics, or is there a public policy, public finance angle to it? Give us a working definition in 2 minutes.
The world over, early childhood development looks at the continuum of childhood from birth to around 8 years of age. And why does it look at this continuum? Because as we know that the child's brain is not really built, is built and not born. Mm-hmm. And why does that happen? We know that 90% of the brain's development happens by the time that the child is 5 years of age. When you say a working definition of ECD, the comprehensive ECD understanding includes the child, of course, at the center of it, but it's not just limited to the child. It is about, as you mentioned, very closely interlinked to the mother's issue, to the women's issue. And the third component of early childhood development would include the caregivers, because this is the whole combination of the child with the mother at home, and the caregiver who's providing the stimulation and care becomes a comprehensive early childhood issue then.
And by caregivers, you mean the creche care workers?
Primarily, yes, we would say that it is the creche caregivers, it is the Anganwadis or the Balwadi care workers. Anybody who is engaged in providing services, stimulation, best practices to the child from the birth to the 8 years of age would be qualifying as a caregiver for the child.
Neelam, your definition from the world of super speciality and ICUs?
Yeah, I would say that the brain starts developing right from conception. So it is from the time a woman conceives a baby, the baby's brain, the baby's whole individuality starts growing. So it also depends upon the environment in utero, that is maternal health, the kind of environment in which the mother is, the mother's mental makeup also. So that's why from conception to the first month is called the perinatal period, which is the most vulnerable as far as the survival.
So that's why we are almost stagnating. There's a plateau of about 7,000 deaths per...
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Because that's the most vulnerable period. And we have, mind it, we have a very large burden of stillbirths also. Uh-huh. Those babies who die in utero. Mm-hmm. These are the deaths which are unknown, which are like hidden deaths. So, and then from 1 month to 1 year, which is called infancy, then it's like one year to 3 years when they are preschoolers, they are at home, and then 3 to 6 years when they go to the preschool. So anything around this time, their health, their environment, their stimulants, their nutrition would decide their mental, their physical growth, their social, their later on how they...
That's the perfect segue for the next question. We'll come back to that. Aapka, Vishesh Tippani?
Dehi, whatever has been said, I entirely agree with that. That the age group which is most relevant is 0 to 2 years or 3 years. Because during this age group, mental development takes place. And if the child does not get proper nutrition, then his or her cognitive skills will not develop. Of course, health, nutrition, and after that, early education, they are all interlinked. But there are also problems both at the level of government, in the design of programs, as well as there are sociological issues. Early girl gets married very early, and the first child is born very early, breastfeeding is not done, then exclusive breastfeeding is not done, sanitation, drinking water, all these are issues which need to be...
We'll talk about the determinants also. So we keep hearing about the advertising slogans. UNICEF has a fantastic slogan, like diamonds are forever, 1,000 days are forever. And by 1,000 days, they mean 9 months of pregnancy and 2 years of the child after birth. So India Sprint has put out an analysis last year that the states with the healthiest children are the ones with the healthiest mothers also. Since you started, that was the entry point. Why didn't you tell us what are the determinants of ECD and how much of the responsibility is actually with the mother? Because it's very easy to do victim blaming. But actually, how much is it mother? How much of it is the state and the society and even people like
us? In fact, there are several issues here. Mother's responsibility is the lack of knowledge.
Dr. Saxena padhate hain, padhte hain, bahut sare bureaucrats ko train kiye hain. Mic mein bolna, Facebook live karna unke liye naya duniya hai.
Thank you for correcting me. But as I was saying, that there are certain behavioral changes which are needed at the level of the mother. But the responsibility lies with government, and the programs which are being designed to address these issues of nutrition, early child development, have a design flaw. The ICDS, which is meant for this, does not look after the younger age group. It is obsessed with 3 to 5 years. It is obsessed with food. It is obsessed with Aganwadi, because the child who is just 1 year old cannot walk to the Aganwadi. Aganwadi worker has to go to the household and then talk to the mother or grandmother and everyone and address these issues. And then there is an issue of accountability. If you look at the registers or the data which is maintained at the Aganwadi center, you will find that there is hardly any, just about 1% or 2% children who are declared as severely malnourished. I was comparing the NFHS 4 data with government data. In Jharkhand,
For our viewers, NFHS National Family Health Survey is the gold standard of the surveys on both health and health determinants. We have had a 10 years hiatus between NFHS 3 and 4. And we've done a lot of work. We've written a lot about data censorship and the increasing scare of data censorship. So we hope to get Dr. Saxena back into that episode also. We do mean to do deep dive around data issues also.
So what I was saying was that if you look at the data which is reported by the state government, that is from the Aganwadi Center to the CDPO to the collector to the state government, hardly 0.5% children are declared as severely malnourished according to the state government. When NFHS 4 survey was done, and before that UNICEF had done a detailed survey, 16% children were severely malnourished. This is grade 3 and grade 4. Combined with the fact that stunting and wasting is not being measured at all. But even if we look at underweight children, you find that there is no accountability, and there appears to be collusion right along the line from the Aganwadi Center to the CDPO, etc., not to report the correct figure. So therefore, accountability is totally destroyed. Plus, of course, because the focus is on distributing ready-to-eat food, there is massive corruption. There are studies showing that in UP...
We'll talk about the state specific. Can you tell us a little about the society determinants? It's already covered ground on state.
In terms of the society determinants, I think one of the facts that you raised, Viraj, is that early child care is looked as the woman's burden. And the burden of unpaid care on a woman is not quantified, it is not monetized. This woman who has to go out and make her own living has to look at home and hearth, including childcare. And as Dr. Saab just mentioned, that there is sometimes lack of awareness of what really early stimulation is, what really good feeding practices is, what constitutes a healthy, nutritious diet, why exclusive breastfeeding in the first 6 months is important, how to transition the baby into solid foods. There are information gaps. There is an awareness gap over there. And therefore, the society perpetuates this kind of intergenerational poverty by continuing to look at childcare as a mother's burden, and unpaid care work is not recognized. That, I think, would be the biggest societal burden. And of course, I mean, what Dr. Saab is saying in terms of the implementation challenges in the government, there is the bigger societal challenges that the young child is not a priority. Mm-hmm. There is no political will to look at a young child as the youngest citizen of the country, and therefore the youngest citizen is entitled to a right to early childhood care, which starts from before birth to 8 years of age, and not like fragmented, like what Dr. Saab is saying, that the ICDS starts from age three onwards, and purely as a feeding center, really. What is happening to the stimulation? What's happening to the health requirements there?
So, Dr. Clay, you are part of a state-of-the-art institution, which also is known to give a lot of charitable services. And you yourself have been a global leading light on sort of pushing the envelope and thinking around neonatology care, pediatrics care, and stuff like that. the images of parents with limp bodies, scores of parents with, I'm still getting goose flesh, with limp body of their dead children in Gorakhpur, in Farrukhabad, in Jharkhand, in Chhattisgarh is not very recent. What do you think, as somebody who's sort of both in the policy and the programmatic circle at the state of the art, what do you think, especially for people, most of the children and the parents who are not able to access the kind of care that your institution provides, when we talk early childhood care, what do you think it would mean for your cohort of people?
See, unfortunately, we make noise only when a news of 800 babies dying in one of the community, not community, in a medical college.
Medical college hospital.
They make a news heading. But thing is that we know that the quality health care is not available in public hospitals. And it's a known fact. We have poor infrastructure. If you look at the physician-patient ratio, we have the poorest. We have 0.7 physicians for 1,000 patients, which is like one-third of what is average. Even the nurse-patient ratio is 1/8. So if we have hospitals which are not equipped, which do not have the manpower, the human resource, which is the most important, then just blaming at one given time is not the answer.
Yeah.
I mean, if we are not going to make health as a priority, if you're not going to make child health as a priority, then why we are, you know, sort of making big noise about young population? What is happening to that young population?
But pura desh youth ke upar chal raha hai.
Dekhiye, aise nahi, aise mera isme thoda sa isme matbhed hai.
Just before you start, for our listeners and viewers, since this is an explainer series, the World Health Organization mandates at least 1.6 doctors per 1,000 patients. And what Dr. Claire said is that we have less than 0.7 doctors, so it's almost less than half, almost one-third doctors per 1,000 patients.
Age should be the ratio.
Human resources for health is the Achilles heel in the health sector, and the underfunding has been a major issue. Pichle saal Rajya Sabha ne Parliamentary Standing Committee ko likha tha. Actually, the Parliamentary Standing Committee and Rajya Sabha wrote to the government before the budget was tabled that we need to at least reach the 2.5% of GDP allocation for health, which is still lagging at 1.3.
What I was saying is that for any program to succeed, you need both demand from the people and supply from government.
Mm-hmm.
Now it so happens that for some programs like nutrition or like preventive health, the demand from the people is also weak, supply is also weak. But for programs like curative health or education, people want these services but not being provided by government. Now, as regards health, the main issue is not only that we are not spending enough, which is 3%, at least 3% of GDP on health, but the absenteeism among doctors or the total lack of care for patients, etc., that's also a very important factor. Plus, if you look at the district chain of
command,
you will find that there are doctors present only at the district hospital. At the community health center or at the primary health center, the doctors are not present. That is why the attendance or the occupancy of beds at the community health center level is very poor. Hardly 25% beds are being utilized. But at the district level, you will find where there are doctors, you will find it could be 300%. So therefore, there is a mismatch. You are right that, you know, we don't have enough doctors. But even when doctors are there, I have often seen that when a doctor is present at the CHC, there are no patients. When I go to the village, I ask, why don't you go there? Sir, what is the guarantee that he will be there? Even if he is there, there are no medicines. I will go straight to a medical shop. There is a fellow who will tell me, yes, you have got the cough, you take this, you have got diarrhea, you take this, I come back. So therefore, the presence of doctors is an issue, lack of medicines is an issue, and also the kind of attitude That is also an issue. And most doctors are busy in private practice. This is also known.
So I guess what
could commit small men. Sure. But you know, when you are talking about newborn deaths, she was mentioning particularly about neonatal deaths.
Yeah.
For neonatal deaths, apart from the doctors, you also need the infrastructure.
Right.
We know that the infrastructure in the public hospitals is
good. Actually, we have a dedicated question for that also. So what we've heard till now is that it will be naive to just look at early childhood development and de-link it and decouple it from either maternity entitlements, maternal health, or the larger health sector and the kind of infrastructural and public finance investment that happens and how that has a knock-on impact on early childhood development, right? So, but having said that, I'm going to be killed to ask the next question. Unfortunately, we live in the era of voodoo economics. Everything has to go through the litmus test of cost-benefit analysis. So, bachche vote dete nahi hai. Yuva ka naam pel ke hum elections jeet jaate hain. So why should we, number one, what is the return on, I know this is, sounds as insensitive as anything can, but what is the return on investment in investing in early childhood development? What are the impact, both financial and social, if we do not make that kind of investment? Sumitra? And please don't judge me for that, asking that question.
Of course, Biraj, I will not respond to your direct question in a direct answer, because economizing and unitizing and monetizing children would be a dreadful thing to do. But I do understand your larger perspective, that in the world, in the capital market economy world that we live in, how does it feed into the macro growth of the country? And it is a no-brainer that if you are investing in the youngest period of a childhood, then how you are helping the child to develop, to become a productive, contributing citizen of the nation, thereby leading to better economic growth of the country, that really is a no-brainer. There are some studies that say that, you know, by investing in early childhood care leads to a 10 to 17% contribution into the larger economy of the country.
So that is by preventing
by investing
in healthcare cost in future.
In a combination of all, it's the
better productive, efficient workforce.
The burden on healthcare reduces. There is better productivity. There is better workability, working skills of young citizens. So a combination of that leads to around a 10 plus percentage of development. But before I head off to the next question, I just want to make a point that when we are talking of investing in child health and neonatal health and in this period, I think the one of the other challenge has been that every time we read a newspaper headline of 800 deaths or starvation related, hunger related deaths, we try and look at only that part. We would look at only
we'll talk about the expectations. Since News Laundry is a media critique platform, we are more than open to listen about expectations from journalism, especially around this issue. So we will talk about that, and we will actually, we have dedicated many episodes to that. We really want to have proper conversation. आपने नंबर क्रंचिंग किया है? What is the cost of inaction if you don't invest?
ऐसा है कि इस बारे में बहुत स्टडी हो चुकी हैं, that if you are able to reduce infant mortality rate.
अब देखिए कृषि कल्याण सेस दे रहे हैं,
जी,
स्वच्छ भारत सेस दे रहे हैं, जीएसटी ने तो कमर ही रीढ़ की हड्डी तोड़ दी, अब अर्ली चाइल्डहुड डेवलपमेंट में उसी से पैसे निकलेंगे, है ना? निकल नहीं पा रहे हैं तो आई प्रिज्यूम इट इज अ पब्लिक फाइनेंस रिसोर्स एलोकेशन इशू. But do you think right now the kind of investments which are going through, let's say, flagship program like ICDS and health, is that enough, number one? And number two, what would be the return on investment?
But as regards the second question, there are plenty of studies to show that as health improves, there is also very, very fast decline in poverty, because health expenditure is one of the most compelling factor which leads even well-off people into the below poverty line. And also it will improve GDP also. So therefore there is a very good data, and which shows that GDP will go up by 3 to 5%, therefore we can go from 7 to 10 or to 12% if we invest in health. But the issue this year, your first question was, what was the other point that you raised?
About considering the kind of taxes that we are giving
That's a very important question.
Now, is the allocation adequate?
Allocation depends on a number of factors. First of all, our total tax collection, we should be, if you compare ourselves with other BRICS countries like Brazil or Russia or South Africa, where it is about 35% of GDP collected as taxes, we are only around 17%, because half of our economy is black economy. So from this...
Abhi bhi nahi hai.
Notbandi ke baad to aur girega. So therefore, there has been in the last 4-5 years some increase, but that is only marginal.
But is that money going to children or is it going to defense procurement?
I am coming to that. Now what has happened is, in 2015, the Finance Commission decided that we will increase untied devolution to the states from 32% to 42%. And the allocation of centrally sponsored programs correspondingly has been reduced. Now, Government of India says that we are giving more money to the state, they should invest in these programs. When I went to Bihar and I talked to the Chief Secretary, he said, look, if I have money, I would much rather spend it on roads. Because roads will not disappear, roads will be there. But if I appoint more teachers or more doctors, what is the guarantee that they would really serve the people? The people will not vote for us. So politically
speaking, Bihar mein teacher doctors mein spend karo to wo sab US chale jayenge,
sab US se chale jayenge,
games wale yahan rahenge wo chale jayenge,
US mein jayenge wo private practice karenge Patna mein.
Acha,
there is a study show that around Lucknow, if you draw a circle of 100 kilometers, almost all doctors
of Uttar Pradesh,
of all those districts, Gonda, Bahraich, Baramati, etc., they have their clinic in Lucknow or Kanpur, and they are doing private practice. And there is a certain amount of bribe that you have to pay to the chief medical officer, to the politician, to the MLA. That's how it is. It's a big racket.
But do you want to sort of put, like Sumitra put, as 10-17% enhancement in GDP if you invest
that's
in children?
Very good. Very correct. There are data to show that.
So for our viewers and listeners, basically, if we are not investing in our children, that's a immediate dip of 10-17%. But I think, as Sumitra is right, we should not be economizing and looking at children as utilitarian, with utilitarian perspective. Dr. Clay, again, I'm sorry. Yes, you are right. We will only talk about it because BRD Medical College happened. But I think it is the shame of BRD Medical College will also shake especially the journalistic fraternity, to talk about it more often and with more care and caution. So the United Nations just came out with its interagency report, which is co-authored by the WHO and the World Bank plus the UN agencies. And they say that the achievements are actually massive. Ye khali rona dhona wala story nahi hai. In fact, abhi my friend Gaurav Jain has just sent it the data. NFHS 3, Dr. Saxena bata rahe the, NFHS 3 2005-06 mein the infant mortality rate in India was 57. As of 15-16, it is 41. So that's 16 deaths per 1,000? Yeah, 100,000.
1,000.
16 deaths per 1,000 live births that we have reduced. So a bit of a pat in the back. Though I'm sure Dr. Saxena will say that's not good enough. And globally, the reduction in the infant mortality has been from, hold your breath, in 1990 it was 12.6 million children, now it is to 5.6 million children, last year 2016. However, so which is about an average of 15,000 children still dying unnecessarily every single day from preventable diseases. But the biggest challenge is what exactly Dr. Clare heads, that is the neonatal deaths. That seems to have plateaued at 7,000 babies dying before 28 days of their life, on an average in the world. And the five countries which contribute maximum to the burden are in Southern Asia and Sub-Saharan Africa. India contributes 24% of the global neonatal deaths. Pakistan 10%, Nigeria 9%, Democratic Republic of Congo 4%, and Ethiopia 3%. Maji ki baat ye hai ki the only country which is actually stable with peace and a robust democracy is India. The other four countries actually have conflict and can have an excuse of failed systems, which is not an excuse that we have. So what exactly are we doing wrong? And massively wrong, it seems, as per the figures.
Yeah. You're right that, you know, the neonatal mortality has almost become static. And even if we look at under 5 mortality, it has come down. But in fact, the neonatal mortality has increased from 41 to 46.
That's
percentage of under 5 mortality.
Khali India or globally?
I'm talking about India. I'm talking about India. So that means in India, we are not making any
progress
with the neonatal mortality.
Yeah.
And that is because, you know, the neonatal mortality is engraved into more larger aspects of life. And it has a lot to do with the money, with the quality health care, with the voice of poor, reach to a hospital where a newborn can be saved. So I think there is no other way but to improve the infrastructure of public hospitals.
So Dr. Saxena talked about the lack of accountability amongst the doctors. I have heard you oftentimes, and I think that's what actually caught my attention about you. You talked about the lack of autonomy and agency when a patient, especially a poor patient, reaches a hospital and how intimidating that space is.
Absolutely.
Do you think that also in a way contributes to the building of the overall unaccountability and also child deaths or no?
No, it does. Like, you know, a patient, let's say from a basic community health center, would not like to go to a medical college.
How it manifests is when BRD hospital crisis happened, Ravish Kumar ne ek prime time mein bola that one of the parents asked the doctor ki humne bacche ko dekha nahi hai, ICU mein 3 din se hai, dikha dijiye hume. So it seems the nurse shot back saying, "Abhi discharge kar dete hain, ghar le lena, dekhte hi rehna." That's the kind of conversation that happens. That's the kind of lack of autonomy that we are talking about. Please go ahead.
Yeah. So, like you know, a patient is scared of going to a higher center because they feel that they'll be lost there. Nobody will listen to them. And when they reach there again, as you said, they feel lost. But then at the same time, we should blame the public hospitals also because they are like, you know, they are also stretched. The services are stretched. You know, on one bed, there are 2 babies or 3 babies. They do not have enough oxygen medication. So I think unless and until we see where is the mismatch, blaming only the doctors and the nurses is also not the correct way. And the thing is that, you know, we have to build that referral system where at least the district hospitals are empowered because they are more nearer than the medical college. And I think one of the program which was like building special care newborn units in the district hospitals, which in fact was one of the very good programs where, like, you know, there was a sort of a referral system where from a primary health center to community health center and to the district hospital, a sort of a referral system was built. I think what has happened is that, you know, we are investing more into, you know, sort of providing care in the private sector and not strengthening the public hospitals. Maybe not exactly like NHS, but we have to build some sort of very strong system where we know that, you know, a patient goes from lower tier to a higher tier hospital and there is accountability when they reach there, where they report, so that they don't feel lost.
So Dr. Claire is a little subdued today. In one of the earlier meetings, I've heard her saying that Kolabari D should not just be a song, it should be a slogan and an anthem to outrage about the state of our public health system. So I guess much more collaborative.
There's a lot of empathy. And then there's empathy in the doctors, nurses, you know, when you can't do things, you don't have leaders who say, no, you have to save this baby. I mean, it's not that the leaders are not there, you know. I mean, I still admire people who work in the circumstances where the resources are very poor.
Yeah. We are hoping to profile some of them as part of this series, and we are hoping to get some of them. But have you seen Kolabari D, and have you actually seen something happening. Give us a good news. Maybe one of these dates as part of your Supreme Court monitoring.
In fact, there are, of course, people who are very dedicated and they are working quite hard. But you have to look at the systemic issues. Not only the overall expenditure on health is not sufficient, but if you look at the structure of government service in India, you'll find there are too many clerks and orderlies and peons and drivers who are not needed. And people in the line position, like doctors, nurses, teachers, even policemen or judges who can deliver, they are missing. So therefore, not only, you have to increase expenditure, but you also have to look as to how you can make some saving. And then the attitudinal change is really necessary. Doctors, government servants on paper are supposed to do behavioral change. But because they don't live in the village, they don't even live at the block headquarters. They would be living, even people who are supposed to be in Hardoi are in Lucknow. So therefore, they are not even in that district. They would be in some big district because their children, they get a huge salary, so they would like to send their children to good schools. But the point I was trying to make here is that, you know, as regards doctors and nurses, the issue of accountability has to be established. I mean, the other point here is, let me give an example. I was talking to a very competent officer. He was Secretary of Health of Madhya Pradesh. I said, look, these are the issues in health. Why don't you look after these issues? He said, Dr. Saxena, 90% of my time is spent in only transfers and posters. There's so much of pressure from doctors to go to those places where they can make money through private practice. And they bring MLAs, they bring ministers. So all the time I'm just doing transfers and postings. Where is the time to look after policy issues? So therefore it is these establishment issues which are making the whole system dysfunctional.
But then there are standout examples. The Child Health Index developed by, one second, are we getting any audience questions? Wahan pe bhi koi collaborative nahi ho raha hai. Oh, yes, sorry. We've got audience questions. So at least our audience care much more, as Neelam would like them to play. Care. Okay, Rahul Pandey on Facebook. Thank you, Rahul. What can a doctor do for a very sick neonate at PHC level with the terrible infrastructure available there? How many PHCs or even rural hospitals have 26 gauge IV cannula, the yellow color one, for the neonates? Would you like to take that?
If you want to do something, we can do at the most
basic. You can speak to Rahul directly
at the most basic level also. Because I'll give you an example that I work very closely with an NGO called Basic Health, which works in the rural areas of Udaipur. And these sub-centers or the health posts are manned by the nurses. And these nurses can perform deliveries, and these nurses can start IV fluids in a newborn in case it's a sick baby with infection. And many a times they provide the emergency treatment, do the triaging, and then they refer them to the higher hospitals. But many a times, you know, the patients refuse. They say that, no, we are fine here because we'll feel lost at the medical school, in the medical college. But here, since we know the nurse. So I think if there is a will, I mean, as Dr. Saxena put it, that, you know, accountability is one thing. That, you know, if we have staff at PHC or at the community health center or in the district hospital, are they performing their duties? Are they trained enough? Are the protocols or guidelines? You know, in a setup where there is somebody who will hold his staff accountable for what they do, it may be a doctor, it may be a nurse, then that system will perform. A system stops performing if there is nobody who can hold people accountable for what they do. And I think probably that is the most, I think not important but a sad thing that, I mean, I don't want to say because it may be taken in the other way, but in a lot of the government hospitals there is apathy, that
yes.
things cannot change.
Yeah.
So I think that is yeah. killing.
Raman Kirpal, our managing editor, at the risk of being called that this episode has become too academic since it is an explainer series, actually is pe kafi kaam hua hai that all these technical sectors, be it health, be it legal sector, there is a massive hiatus between the users and the service providers, and that kind of power inequity is actually maintained so that service providers can hold a power over the users. So the lack of accountability also comes from that kind of manufactured hiatus. Vivek Mishra is asking on Twitter, and I think this is for both Dr. Saxena and Sumitra, what must be the attitude of parents and how can we help the poor people who don't have basic amenities? Government is not having best scenarios with the best equipment or facilities. So what can we do?
Well, in fact, at the level of parents, mm-hmm. a behavioral change in terms of correct nutrition and also the practices of breastfeeding, etc., which is not being done. Often one finds that a child who is just 2 months old, he or she is given honey or water, which is not correct. So therefore, we need to have a behavioral change at the level of the family. That is not being done because no one approaches them. Aganwadi center worker is busy only at her center. Others are busy doing other things. So therefore, there is hardly anyone
counseling
these people and telling them this is how. When a child gets diarrhea, you often water is denied to them or
yeah.
ORS is denied to the child because they think that it will lead to further
Sumitra, I'll take the discussion a little further down this whole counseling and behavior change paradigm that we've been functioning on, that the parents need to be, there needs to be awareness program to create awareness amongst parents so that they can, you know, be more effective as parents. I think the original discussion that we had was about an agency building amongst parents, building the autonomy of the mothers. How do we build that? Of course, giving right information and right skills in childcare practices is important, but also building the autonomy of the family is equally important. What you've been saying, Dr. Claire, that are parents involved in expressing what their difficulties are when we are
yeah.
looking at policy
okay.
framing? Are they involved in monitoring? Are they a part of the Anganwadi monitoring committees? Are they a part of the village health and nutrition committees? Are they being asked what they think about the services that is due to as their entitlement?
So basically all those platforms
yes.
where they can share their
yes.
feedback on
yes.
the government programs
yes.
and also
yes.
sort of
just
amplify their voices.
Just
yeah.
because they're poor doesn't
yeah.
mean that they don't have the agency
yeah.
and they're passive recipients of government welfare services.
Right.
They have a very active role in the monitoring, implementation and the accountability of these
yeah.
Welfare policies at the ground
yeah.
level.
And Sumitra has a reason to be passionate about it because her organization, Mobile Creches, is actually one of the leading organizations, not just in India, but I think probably South Asia globally, which is working with some of the most marginalized children of migrant and construction workers, trying to give the parents agency also while sort of running state-of-the-art creches for some of the most marginalized children. A good news story. I'm not sure if it's good news because we've sort of been weighed down now. The Child Health Index developed by Ritika Khera and Jean Drez has compiled figures on various indicators for 2005-06 and the UNICEF Rapid Survey of Children 2014. They show Kerala, Himachal Pradesh and Tamil Nadu are doing very well, while Uttar Pradesh scrapes the bottom. So that debate between UP and Chief Minister and Kerala Chief Minister is beyond absurd at one level. And Bihar is showing some very spunky development. But Gujarat has been a laggard, both in 2004-05 data and in 2015-16 data and in the UNICEF Rapid Survey of Children. It ranked 15 amongst 28 states in the UNICEF Rapid Survey of Children. Actually, there's nothing to write home about. And many believe that the reason why the UNICEF Rapid Survey of Children was delayed, its publication was delayed, and there was almost some sort of an unwritten censorship around it, was because of Gujarat's performance in the score. Dr. Saxena, I am make sense for us, for all of us, both our audience and us. So does that mean the economic development does not have a correlation with better child health indicators, number one? And number two, how is it that Bihar is sort of punching up and punching above its weight, whereas Gujarat is sort of punching much far below its weight?
In fact, first of all, I would like to say that if you collect data on, say, underweight children for all the poor countries, starting with the poorest like Malawi up to say, Sri Lanka, and you plot a graph of their per capita income and the number of percentage of malnourished children, the graph goes like this. So there is no correlation at all between per capita income and underweight children up to the level of Sri Lanka. Beyond that, you can say that, okay, UK, USA, per capita income is high, there is correlation. But for the poor countries, there is no correlation.
And why is that?
Because of a large number of factors. Not only it is the child rearing practices, sanitation is a very big factor, quality of water is another factor. So all these factors. The other point is, you know, there are good examples.
So can I get this for our brilliant for our brilliant social media team? You are saying that per capita income has no correlation with child nutrition
up to
underweight in poor countries.
Lower and middle income countries.
Okay.
No, the other point I was saying.
So
is
that's a 140 character
tweet. That's it. Yeah, if you look at Thailand was able to reduce its percentage of underweight children. It was very high at 42. It was in 1980. And from 42, it reduced to 15 in just about 10 years. And how did they do it? They encouraged inter-village competition. They would say, look, in your village, 20% children are underweight. In that village, it has come down to 12%. So that is how the information about underweight children was being shared, and everyone was being enthused and encouraged to take it as a village issue. Unfortunately,
the data is not shared.
Because that data is bogus.
Absolutely. Okay,
so let's that just to comment on Dr. Saab's comment, this whole private school mein jana shaan ki baat hai. I mean, that's the reality. We are talking of early childhood care and education here today, and we see that this whole flight of children towards private schooling. Why are 2.5-year-old, 3-year-old going to the nearby kindergarten school, whereas the Anganwadi, which is within 1 kilometer of the child's residence, is lying locked? Is because the whole perception that the Anganwadi is merely a feeding center, the whole learning, education and stimulation is happening in the private school, and there's a big demand for those private play schools in the neighborhood. I mean, that's the reality. And what are we trying to do as early childhood care and
education to regulate? I've heard Sumitra call mom's joy, kiddies' pride, all these things as fly-by-night franchisee operators. And she thinks all of them should be demolished and public-funded, taxpayer-paid creche care and play school should be there where a maid's and a madam's child can go.
There is
inshallah for that day.
There is place for everyone. All I'm saying is that there is a whole social equality principle that if you cannot afford to send your child to a private kindergarten, your child is entitled to receive good quality early childhood care and education in the Anganwadi system as a part of the public provision. Of course, the choice will always lie with the parent. But if we have good quality public service provision available for young children, then we will not have mushrooming of unregulated private schooling systems. And we don't really know whether it is holistic care and protection. We're basically teaching children to start reading and writing and numbers and arithmetic at a very young age. And that's not early childhood care and education at all.
Okay, we've got another question, but I'm not even sure if this is a question that should belong here, but I mean, we are grateful Wiz of Gaze for asking this question, for logging on. Do the panelists think rotavirus vaccine and implementation should be expedited throughout India? What percentage of lives do they believe it could save? पहले तो सिंपल इंग्लिश में बताइए इसका मतलब क्या है.
रोटा वायरस इज अ वायरल डिजीज विच कॉजेज डायरिया इन इन्फेंट्स, दैट इज इन फर्स्ट सिक्स मंथ्स. The Western data says that 60% of the some data says that 60% of the diarrheas are actually due to rotavirus.
And diarrheal death is one of the biggest reasons for biggest. Child death.
So there is an Indian vaccine which is being developed which is now going to be launched. So probably it's going to become a part of the immunization program in the public health sector also. So I think rotavirus probably is going to help in reducing the diarrheal disease burden.
If you don't want to give a recommendatory line, we would actually
now our Indian vaccine has been developed, so it's going to become a part of the public health immunization system. It's already being adopted by the IAP, Indian Academy of Pediatrics, so it's already there.
And there's evidence that it does save lives. It is not one of those big pharma voodoo solutions.
No, I think immunization is something which is preventive and which is taken well by the government, by the health professional agencies, and it's not something.
So we actually did a series 2 years ago on global development summits where we actually talked about vaccination as a global public good and immunization as a global public good. So just to pick up from where Sumitra left, that is the perfect segue. The crisis of creches in urban India. Aapne ispe kaafi likha hai. You've actually written for me also many moons ago. ActionAid has done some brilliant work. Sumitra has also, her organization has done some research, and we are hoping to profile her research also as part of the series. I think the connection between women's workforce participation and importance of creche care available, affordable creche care is pretty much a given. But still in India, most of what we see is kidsies, mom's joy, cuties and prides primarily commercial establishments like that. We do not get to see public-funded, taxpayer-funded public creches where both a maid and a madam, especially in an informal sector. 2 months ago, we had done a deep dive on the standoff between the madams and the maid, the modern Mahagun society and the domestic workers, Fraka. So the importance of creche care access for the informal workers also. So what do you have to say?
In fact, you're very right that service which should be provided through creches is totally missing. And one of the impact of this is that if you look at the number of women who are employed in urban areas, it's just about 17%. As opposed to about 30% in the rural areas.
Ye kab ka data?
Ye 2011-12 ka, which is the latest. And not only that, despite education in urban areas, you find that women's employment, this includes self-employment, wage employment, casual employment, all for that has remained stagnant at 17%.
Is that because the ICDS program does not have a
cash
component?
That's right. No, it's because ICDS component provides only for certain amount as rent. And in that rent, you cannot have a room.
Achcha.
So therefore, the number of
ICDS, India's flagship program on child development and nutrition, integrated child development
That's
scheme,
right.
is underfunded, and creche is
even more
unfunded.
And it's more underfunded in the urban areas because of lack of space. You require a certain space for accommodating 30, 40 children. That is just not there. So what happens in urban areas is that there is a center which is only for supplying meals. That okay, 12 p.m. you come, collect your meal and go away. That's
so
all.
Kal we heard that the government with your and my money is going to recapitalize the public sector banks, 2,11,000 crore. ICDS mein crash banane ke liye, humare bachon ke liye, kitne crore ki
jarurat hai? Ye toh loan se toh nahi hoga. This is because grant. This is a welfare program.
Yeah.
This has.
नहीं but कितना taxpayers का पैसा खाया? अभी तो हम State Bank और PNB को revive करने में 2,11,000 crore दे रहे हैं.
जी.
तो आप बताइए ICDS में creches के लिए कितना चाहिए?
कम से 50,000 crores.
So our children will get creches. Get some perspective, and hope our social media team will tweet this. So you're saying our children, all the children in India will get creche care at 50,000 crore. And yesterday our finance minister said 2,11,000 crore is going to refinance, recapitalize the public sector banks. That's the kind of money.
That's right. That's okay.
And if you look at the budget, in fact the budget has been reduced for the ICDS by 7%.
Yeah.
This is
2015.
This is last year. Total budget is 7%
reduced. In fact, the child health budget has been also cut down from 15.48 to 14. So, I mean, if you look at the budgetaries have been already reduced, both for ICT.
But that's only the central budget from the
central
government. If you also include the state government budget, then the figure will not be as this much.
And another question is that we have 1.8 million creches covering something like 38 million children.
These are Sarkari creches or everything counted?
This is
Pura
creches. Yeah. Some audit need to be done, how well they are functioning, whether they are delivering something, what are the problems, whether it's the resource, it is the human, or there is apathy or what it is. At least, you know, a lot of money is being, I mean, some audit, some gold standard to see that how well they are.
Do you have benchmarks for creches?
We do have benchmarks for creches. We have a standard operating procedure. We have, in fact, benchmarked our budgets to a way that it can be taken up as a policy intervention in terms of per child cost and creche running cost, including the human resource training cost involved in it. So yes, it is possible within the public provision, but as Dr. Sahu was saying, that the whole informal economy is currently out of the creche mandate. Anganwadi systems do not accommodate children below 3 years of age. Even for children between 3 to 6 years of age at urban centers, it is Anganwadis are operational for only 2 to maximum 3 hours. It doesn't meet the maternity entitlement or the creche and day care requirement of mothers who want to go out and work. So the ICD systems fails over there because it's not 6 to 8 hours of care and protective services available to
So for the mother to work, she would need a creche that takes care of her child for 6 to 8 hours
at least,
a day.
At least 6 to 8 hours, because in an urban setting, that's how long the mother would need to go, even if the mother is working from home.
Commute ka mila lo to
10-12
In Tamil Nadu, there is a system of private creches. 10 or 15 women will get together, appoint a creche worker, caregiver, and they go and work. So
and
Tamil Nadu, you'll find that women's labor employment is higher because of their pain. So it's a purely private sector.
And we have piloted, Mobile Crush has piloted community-based crushes where women from within the community are trained to run a crush in their own home or a shared place for next door neighbor's children.
So we will check her claims also. We want to do it.
Please do.
We want to do a longer
deep dive on. And it's a much
more
sustainable. It's a sustainable model. Because
in urban area, people would be ready to pay also.
And there is some kind of payment also involved in a community based.
But aapke reports mein likha hai ki bahut, a lot of these domestic workers can't even afford, which is why the elder child becomes the virtual caregiver of the younger child,
that's
when they're forced to go into work.
Because there is no system.
Yeah.
Just to add on the creche question, I just want to quickly interject that there are 7 to 8 laws in the country that talks of statutory provision of creches, including the NAREGA, the Plantation Act, the Brickkiln Act, Workers Act, the Factories Workers Act. It is there. The NAREGA creche, definition of creche is shade, drinking water, and one disabled woman as a caretaker. Now, we are completely undermining the whole logic of early childhood care.
Yeah.
It is not about just a protection under a shade and drinking water, which is creche. We started the conversation with comprehensive, holistic care for young children. Second, even when there are so many labor laws that have statutory provision, there is no allocation, there is no implementation. So there is this lack of demand because workers don't have, and these are mostly workers in the informal economy who don't demand the services.
So I think Neelam's call for a public audit is actually a much more important, wider call for audit. It is not just auditing to set up a benchmark for kind of creche that our children deserve in India, but also a benchmark of the kind of laws which have been violated which mandate creches also.
I think, I mean, from mobile creche point of view, I would say that the auditing for benchmarks is not so crucial because there is enough evidence of practice, but an auditing of of wherever there are statutory provisions for creches, what is the situation on the ground? And that includes the various acts that I mentioned. Also, very quickly, the Maternity Benefit Act, which is supposed to give the whole provision of creches to young children and enable women to work in the organized labor force. It is just dividing children even more, because mobile creches...
We will do deeper and longer pieces on maternity benefits and... its implementation and the myopic view of looking at maternity entitlements in South Asia and India also. We have to wrap up this thing. Since we are a media critic and media watch site and we believe in introspecting and being most critical about ourselves, why don't you tell us what are your out moment of Indian journalism when it comes to early child care, Neelam?
I think as intelligent media...
You can also say wow moments of journalism.
We're not investing so much into education, health education. I think that's one area where probably... You know, we do sensationalize the news, which like catches everybody's fancy. But as far
just
as...
Just regular explainer,
yes,
public service
yes,
announcements, PSS. You would like much more PSS.
Yeah, I think there should be much more.
Explainers.
Media should act more pro, giving, sort of more educating or more informatory news also.
But don't
that
you think what
important.
Sumitra said in the beginning, that it is most of the time only sensational, the deeper structural challenges are still never covered.
There is
some sort of blackout.
I think one is that, you know, a lot of people don't know what is their right. And
mm-hmm.
I think somewhere Dr. Saxena also said that, you know, people have to speak that this is their right.
Mm-hmm.
So for that, maybe the media has to educate them that, you know, not only that so many children die, but so many children can die. So we have to ask for that, you know. You have a school in the neighborhood, but there are no teachers. You have to raise your voice.
Your ouch and wah moment of Indian journalism?
My ouch moment is definitely when I see the whole sensationalizing of news. Death catches attention, and it should, and it must lead to some change and some discourse around it. But as an early childhood development person, I think when we focus only on hunger or only on death, we miss the whole narrative of a comprehensive, holistic early childhood development. When we are talking of health, we need to be talking of care. When we are talking of care, we need to be talking of nutrition. Nutrition needs to be talking of early stimulation. I think that comprehensive look at the child as a whole is missing, and we're just looking at one part of the child, and that narrative dies down, goes out of the eyeballs, and then the child is lost again. So that's my real ouch moment there, that we don't look at the child as an active citizen with an agency, rather as a news headline. So that's really a dreadful thing to experience in the media repeatedly. The wow moment, I think independent think tank journalist houses like News Laundry are bringing the whole social discourse.
Bhai Abhinandan Sekri ko bata do ya Sumitra thinks News Laundry is independent think tank journalist house. Hum bhi nahi sochte apne bare mein itna acha chiz.
At least there is a 1 hour dedicated to a discussion about the young child. We talk of the demographic dividend of this country, but we start the discussion from a 16-year-old when the whole Pradhan Mantri skilling India becomes. तुमने birth and as Dr. Saab says from conception to 8 years, तो तुमने miss कर दिया. तुम क्या करोगे?
वो तो स्वयंभू है. वो तो अपने आप हो जाएगा. स्वयंभू है. 16 साल के बाद हम बात करेंगे.
So
अब बताइए.
इसमें एक बात और.
But those are really important points about sort of the narrative, not talking about the politically vocal cohort of, or rather the media narrative talking from 16 and not the ones below that only, because they're not politically vocal, and probably their parents are also poor and indigent and not politically vocal. But vote ke mamle mein they're very, very vocal. It's just that, you know, somehow we've learned the art to invisibilize them when actually it matters.
Children don't have an agency, that's what we believe.
Whether you look at the press or politicians,
aapka outshot wow
moment, or the people, they're all demanding curative health. We need more doctors, more hospitals, more specialists. Preventive health totally gets ignored. Whether children are anemic, whether BCG has been given to them, whether measles has been given to them, polio has been, that these aspects totally get ignored.
Mm-hmm.
Not only that, you find, once I checked up the data of UP, UP government in 2007 was reporting 103% children being immunized. And soon after But when the NFHS3 collected data, it was only 33%. So 33% versus 103%. So ये जो हमारे यहाँ पर है, I was on it for on behalf of UNICEF, I was reviewing polio. Polio drops were not being accepted by a very large number of people in places like Muradabad or Firozabad.
And was there any reportage when this thing came, this 103% immunization vis-a-vis 33%?
Not at all.
So why
doesn't report these things?
So aap mujhe bataiye, ye, I think we also need to stand up for our own fraternity, at least. Do you think because the journalists do not get access to that kind of data, or that data is in a state that it is really difficult to read and report on it?
Well, the data from NHFS 3 or 4 or UNICEF RSOC is available.
Hmm.
But the data which is reported from the state government or by the lower staff, that is not available unless you approach the office concern, or unless you file RTI application. It can be collected, but this will require going to a district or to a block. That generally sitting in Delhi do not like.
So that kind of shoe leather journalism.
That's right, that's right.
So we really hope to bring you back and we talk about the state of data and also the shoe leather journalism that's required to do on state of data. Would you like to say something in the, since we're closing, wrapping up, what is one big policy or program that you would like to see?
Government of India must ban ready-to-eat food.
Okay.
But Government of India is encouraging ready-to-eat food by saying that...
Yeah, abhi toh Maharashtra ka tender cancel hua hai. Scroll has reported about
it. Nahi, Maharashtra mein hua ye hai ki jitne bhi contractors the, they have all set up women's organizations. So, Mahila Samaj bana diya. Contractor driven hai, there are no ladies or members, and they are getting this. So, therefore, they are able to evade the Supreme Court direction that contractors are not allowed. This is our Mahila Sangathan hai, we are producing ready to eat food. So, ye jo ready to eat food hai, jisse itna corruption ho raha hai, and the entire attention of the staff gets diverted. The whole program is food based. It is not nutrition, advice,
counseling,
all
immunization.
It's food packet distribution.
One big expectation, headline expectation.
Crèches. Yeah. Crèches, priority to crèches. There is enough in terms of schemes or programs or policies, including the latest National Nutrition Mission that recognizes crèches as that institutional mechanism for preventing of undernutrition. I think for me the biggest thing would be, let's just push the discourse of crèches and the implementation of crèches.
So you'd like to see them take shape beyond the paper.
Beyond the paper, into practice.
Paper mein toh humne kitna kuch bana liya.
Bahut bari baat kar li.
Dr. Claire?
We didn't touch the latest Nourish India Kuposhan
Malnutrition Free 2020.
Yeah, a very, very ambitious program which is going to be steered by the ICDS and helped by a lot of departments and
113 districts will become
and in fact there has been a survey before that, and they have identified the 100 districts which are the
113
badly performing districts,
high burden districts,
and they have looked, I mean they have a package of interventions for both the young child as well as the mother, the adolescent, for the community and all. It's a very, very ambitious program which is made by the think tank of India.
The Niti Aayog.
The Niti Aayog. But, I mean, before
you are hopeful
it is
about
came,
that?
I'm hoping. I'm hoping because this came exactly after the national policy,
right,
which looked at, which was performed by the applied, I think, ASEER. applied economics, by people from applied economics.
National Council for Applied
National
Economic
Council
Research.
For applied medicine. And they did mention that, you know, we need to do something about it, and they talked about the ECM.
Now that is a think tank. We are a pretend think tank. We're not
yes.
even a think tank. That is actually
you're
a
right,
tank.
You're right. They've done some really good work. The thing is that before, you know, it is scaled up, I think probably some sort of smaller scale intervention applied to few district and doing the auditing and the outcome before we can, you know, say really that, you know, these interventions are.
So for our viewers and listeners, the program that Dr. Clary is mentioning was announced only last month by the Ministry of Women and Child Development with a lot of determinant ministries that Dr. Saxena has been telling, drinking water and sanitation, agriculture, health. It is called the Malnutrition Free India by 2020, Mission Malnutrition Free India 2022. Event ke jamane mein, spectacles or images ke jamane mein, I think she is hopeful that this will be much more than that. I am also hopeful, even the cynical part of me, I think journalism sort of gives a right for us to be skeptical and cynical, but the cynical and the skeptical part of me still celebrates the fact that there is enough public pressure, at least even if it is an event or an announcement. The fact that that announcement is being made means it gives both the citizen, the civil society and journalism a big handle to hold the powers that be accountable around Malnutrition Free India 2022. We'll take an up close and personal look at that mission, what it constitutes, India's flagship program ICDS also in the next episode. So let me quote Tim Evans, the senior director at the World Bank. He said, it is unconscionable that in 2017, pregnancy and childbirth are still life-threatening conditions for women, and that, let this number sink in, 7,000 newborns die daily. The best measure of success for universal health coverage is that every mother should not only be able to access healthcare easily, but that it should be quality, affordable care that will ensure a healthy and productive life for her children and family. That was our kicker episode of our series on early childhood. We'll publish the video podcast on News Laundry site too for those of you who want to listen and ingest all the fantastic messages and the analysis that our panelists put out. Are aur bhi a question aa gaya? No, I think, is there another question? One second. A big thank you to our panelists, our kick-ass panelists, for joining for this launch episode. A big thank you to the viewers who logged in and hopefully would also be watching it on YouTube in the website. Big shout out to Shubham Mishra, producer of this episode. Our sound recordist, Anil. Our social media, Smriti. And Abhinandan Sekri for endorsing the series, and Raman Kirpal for his guidance and inputs. Big shout out to the international, in case you were wondering what was the fellowship that Sumitra thinks that has got the goodness of our heart to start dedicated series. Actually, there's a positive inducement also. Big shout out to the International Center for Journalists, Washington DC, for my fellowship, which is sort of encouraging us to do this through the year. We'll come back next week with a deep dive on India's performance in country and vis-a-vis the world, and how some of the states are faring, who are the laggards, who are the heroes. Watch this space, but more importantly, engage. Please support independent media, please support News Laundry, so you can decide what matters and why early childhood matters. This is Birat Swain signing off.